like to share with you, if God will allow me to, a few topics that I've prepared, just short topics. So I've got several titles for you. The first one I want to share about is titled, How Deeply God Knows You. How deeply He knows you. Amen. Psalms 139, verse 23. The psalmist says, Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my anxious thoughts. I'll read that again. It says, Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my anxious thoughts. You know, we rarely think about that, how much God knows us, because we spend so much of our time trying to get to know God. You know, it's so important, church, and the Holy Spirit just laid this on my heart right now. It's so important that we understand this. We spend all our time trying to get to know God, but we forget how much He knows us. You know, when those who came to Christ at the end time, on the judgment day, and they cried out of how much they did for Christ, God said, Depart from me. You never knew me. That's not what He said, is it? He said, Depart from me. I never knew you. Mm-hmm. Have you ever thought about that? Why did God say that for? But He's God. Surely He knows. But He said, no. He said, Depart from me. I never knew you. He didn't say, You never knew me. See, because we spent so much time getting to know Him, studying Him, reading about Him, listening about Him. See, we know Him. But that's not what counts. Sometimes. There's many people who will not enter heaven, and yet they know all about God. They know everything there is to know about God. They can preach, and when they preach about Jesus Christ, many souls will be saved. They know all about Him. But we rarely think about how much He knows us. He said, Depart from me. I never knew you. And I like this psalm. It says, Try me and know my anxious thoughts. See, we often have to sometimes go back in our times of silence, in our times of meditation, and meditate on how much God knows us, how deeply He knows us. It's the most comforting thing when we just can be silent and think about how much He knows us. And it says that He knows my anxious thoughts. When you're there concerned and being anxious about your education, God knows those thoughts. Your future, God knows those thoughts. Your family, He knows those thoughts. Whatever it is that you are anxious about, that you are concerned about, your finance, He knows your thoughts. So many of us are concerned about our health. God knows those thoughts. We're concerned about our family. Perhaps there's trouble in your family. God even knows those thoughts. He knows your anxious thoughts. Psalm 94, verse 11. He then says, The Lord knows people's thoughts. He knows they are worthless. He knows people's thoughts, and He knows that they are worthless. Amen? God knows how worthless sometimes our thoughts can be. One moment we're saying, one day we wake up and we're saying, I'm going to do it. And then the wind blows. And then we're saying, well, I don't think I can. One moment you say, I promise I'll achieve it. And then before you know it, you wake up in the morning and your heart is changed and you're wondering, can I really do that? Worthless thoughts. How often we spend so much of our life thinking about something, planning something, designing something, and all along God knows that it's worthless. Because just a week later, you scrapped everything, starting all over again. So all those time that you spent thinking those thoughts, God knew all along that it was worthless. We need to start thinking about how deeply God knows us. You know, when you know how deeply God knows you, you will not waste your time thinking things. You will spend more time bringing your thoughts to God because He knows everything about you. He knows you deeply. Most people, they overestimate their own ability. Most of us think that we're great. Most of us think that we can do anything. Most of us believe that if I can set my mind upon anything, I can do it. That's what motivational speaking tells you. It's not true. You can set your mind on many things and you'll never achieve it. Because God has not created us all equal. We are unequal. Just because my brother achieves it doesn't mean I can achieve it. No matter how much I study, no matter how much I set my thoughts on. Spend more time taking your thoughts to God and inquiring from the Lord, Father, are these thoughts, are these plans, are my ambitions actually worth doing? You will waste half of a lifetime with worthless thoughts. Think about it. Before you achieve anything, how many thoughts did you have before that? How much time? How many weeks and months? And worst case scenario is when you put your money towards it and you make investments and you purchase things. And so not just are you wasting your thoughts, you're now wasting your money. And then it gets even worse when you tell everybody and everybody else starts to believe in it. And then there's a group of you, a family, all believing in something which all along God knew that's just a worthless thought. See, it is not a bad thing when we question our thoughts. See, we think in our hearts that if I have a thought, I'm going to, by the end of this month, I'm going to achieve something. And then I start to think, but can I really achieve it? That's not doubt. Not in a bad sense. It's called humility. See, you are bringing it to God. You have a thought, you have a plan, but then you want to take it back to God and say, Lord, by the end of this month, can I really achieve this? Is this really what you want? Is this really the thing that you want to do in my life? Are you going to be with me in this, Lord? Hallelujah. You wake up in the morning and you have a dream, and you say, I'm going to do it. By the next morning, you have another dream, and you've changed your vision. You say, I'm going to set up this business, and I'm going to sort my life out. You get to the business plan, and it falls apart. If only we knew how to turn to God. If only we knew how much God knew us, how deeply He knows us. It will save us so much heartache, so much time, if we just knew how deeply God knows us. Can you turn with me to the book of Numbers, chapter 23, verse 19? It says, God is not a man, so He does not lie. He is not human, so He does not change His mind. Has He ever spoken and failed to act? Has He ever promised and not carried it through? Amen. God is the most trustworthy advisor you can possibly have. And He's got the most perfect advisor of all. It's called the Holy Spirit. He's your counselor. He will counsel you on everything that you need to do. He will make sure that your life, every minute of your life, is worthwhile. And you don't pursue worthless dreams that will end up nothing. He says, God is not a man. He does not lie. We lie to ourselves all the time. We say we can do things that we cannot. We make promises that you know deep in your heart that you cannot. And even when you know that you cannot, your heart is so hard and your head is so strong, you say, I will. But really, you know that you can't. So you're lying to yourself, but God is not a man. God is not you. He's not me. He does not lie. Then it says He does not change His mind. How many things have you decided you're going to do in just this year? If you wrote down everything that you said you're going to achieve, How many times have you changed your mind? Just think, by the beginning of the year, had you known what God's plan was, and you set your mind to what God said, where would you be right now? I want you to really think about how deeply God knows you. See, we pursue things that God has no intention for us. And when you tell someone, listen, this is not God's will for you, their heart is too hard and their head is too strong. And they say, you watch, I'm going to do it. And you just sit back and you watch. After a little while, you're looking at them and you're thinking, well, I thought you were going to do it. It all falls apart. It says, has he ever spoken and failed to act? That's going back to the promises. We make promises that we always fail to act on. You say you want to do something and you fail to do it because you don't have the ability to do it. You don't have the discipline. You don't have the training or the skills to do it. But God does not fail to act. And finally says, has he ever promised and not carried it through? Every promise that God's ever given to your life, he will achieve it. If you've ever received a prophecy that has come from God, it will come to pass. The Bible tells us that his thoughts are not like our thoughts. His ways are not like our ways. See, when you have a thought, you see, what is it with us human beings that whenever I have a thought in my mind of something that is good for my life, automatically, without even praying about it, I assume that that's what God wants for me. What is it with us? You have a thought of an idea that's really going to change your life. And then when you even pray and ask God, even if it's not God's will, you hear God tell you, is my will, do it. That's your own spirit speaking, it's not God. See, we need to learn to separate our thoughts from God's thoughts. His thoughts are not our thoughts, his ways are not our ways. You need to learn to separate them. Every thought that you have concerning your life, if it's not God's thought, it will fail. Amen. It cannot prosper. Yes. So we've got to be able to separate our thoughts from God's thoughts. And be able to distinguish the difference. How many times have you done that before? I know I have, thousands of times. When I've prayed something which I really wanted in my heart, and I'm sure that God said I should do it. I'm absolutely certain. I even hear the Holy Ghost tell me to do it. And then when I take the first step, I fall. And I go back to God, I say, Lord, I thought you said. And he stays quiet. He never spoke. We have to learn to separate the difference between God's thoughts and our thoughts. God knows us deeply. He knows you more than you know yourself. So when you say, I can jump and reach that high, God knows how high you can really jump. You think you can because your faith tells you that you can. You're confident that you can. But you can't. See, we need to learn to be humble enough to be able to go back to God and say, Lord, can I really jump that high? Lord, you know me deeply. You know everything there is to know about me. Can I really achieve that? It's not a bad thing to ask God that question. You know, there's a man in the Bible who God tells him, if you have faith, that you can have faith in anything and you can have it. And then the man says to Jesus, he says, Lord, I do believe. But then I like the next thing that he says. He said, Lord, help my unbelief. Do you know that part? He turns to Jesus and says, Lord, I do believe in you, but help my unbelief. See, this is the words of a man who knows that Christ knows him deeply. My heart, my head tells me I believe. I know that I can reach it, but Lord, can I really reach it? Help my unbelief. Are you understanding? We need to know that God knows us deeply. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. It says, give all your worries and your cares to God, for he cares about you. God cares about you. There are too many prodigal sons in the church. There are too many prodigal sons. There are too many of us who think that we can go without God. You can never become too mature for God. You can never become too old for God. Even though you have everything right there before your own hands, go back to God. Even if you think that everything is finalized, I finally made it, go back to God. Even when you say it is finished, I finally got what I always wanted, go back to God. It says, give all your worries and your cares to God, for he cares about you. God cares about us. Psalms 55, verse 22. It says, give your burdens to the Lord, and he will take care of you. He will not permit the godly to slip and fall. Amen? We can almost read that scripture backwards. I'm just going to read it one more time. Please pay attention. It says, give your burdens to the Lord, and he will take care of you. He will not permit the godly to slip and to fall. Now, if we read that scripture backwards, it tells you this, that if I slip and I fall, that means somewhere down the line, I didn't give my burdens to the Lord. Somewhere down the line, I did not go back to God. If you find that your life suddenly faces a crash or a brick wall, and every thought and investment that you spent all this time planning and praying about, and then suddenly you meet a brick wall, somewhere down the line, you didn't really consult God. Church, it is always, listen, a Christian technically is never ever supposed to fail. Amen. We are never supposed to fail. He said, I have overcome the world. He said, all that is mine is yours. And he said that I have overcome the world. We are not supposed to fail. We're supposed to be the head, not the tail, above, not beneath. Why do we fail? Because somewhere down the line, we did not consult God. Before you make any decision, if it took you 1 week to make a decision, spend another week consulting God. Don't move until you know for sure it's God's will. Otherwise, you'll just waste that week. You'll end up just wasting more time. Have we not had enough of failure? Have we not had enough of brick walls? Have you not had enough of reading the scriptures telling you that you're more than conquerors, and yet your life evidently shows that you are a failure? Have you not had enough of looking at the Bible and not seeing your life reflected in the promises of God? 99.9% of the time is because we don't consult him. He knows you so deeply. If you are a television, God is the manual. He knows exactly how you work. He knows how many channels you've got. He knows everything there is to know about you. Whatever you can achieve, he knows it. He knows your strengths, your abilities. He knows your weaknesses. He knows everything. To go without him is like to buy an expensive piece of equipment and then say, I don't need the manual, I can just work it out myself. Somewhere down the line, you're going to crash. Am I speaking to anybody here?
Amen.
Psalms 46, verse 1. It says, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in time of need. What more do you need to hear? God is our refuge. He protects us. He's our shelter. He's our strength. And he's always ready to help us in times of need. When you find yourself in a stuck situation and you're crying out to God and God is not answering, it means you made a mistake somewhere. Somewhere down the line, you walked away from him. You made a choice, you made a decision without consulting him. You know, whenever we do that, whenever we make a decision without consulting God, it's as though you depart from him. He goes this way, you go that way. That is one thing that always, you know, the Bible tells us that God's hands are not short. right? He can reach you in whatever situation that you are in. But the only time he cannot reach you is when you depart from him. When you make a conscious decision to make a plan without consulting him. That is the only time God can't reach you. That's when Satan will come and he'll mess about with you. And the worst times of your life will start. When everything falls apart. Because we don't consult him. I want us to go to the book of Psalms. Chapter 38. And perhaps when you're studying this sermon at home, I want you to read the entire chapter. In this chapter is a prayer that David prays, King David. And in this prayer, you need to understand, when you read the whole chapter, you'll see it. This was a time of great anguish and exhaustion for him. Everything that he knew had fallen apart. His family turned away from him, and he had nothing. Okay? And on top of that, he believed, because he was suffering greatly, and he was ill. And he believed that his suffering and all that he was going through is because of his sin. And so in the midst of all of that, he then prayed. And Psalms 38 is the prayer that he prays. But this is the only part that I want you to pay attention to. Just because of time, we're not going to go through it. Verse 9. Now imagine, just remember everything that I just told you, what this man is going through. Everything is turned away from him, and he feels that God is allowing him to suffer because of his sins. Okay? And then this is what he says right in the middle of this prayer. Verse 9, he says, "You know what I long for, Lord. You know what I long for." You see that, church? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you still with me?
Amen.
Psalms 38, verse 9. Here is a man whom everything has fallen apart from. He's made some pretty bad decisions. And he's facing what I was just talking about, that brick wall. And right in the middle of the prayer, he says, "You know what I long for." And the next verse is, "Lord, you hear my every sigh." Amen? I can see that you don't understand this. Let me explain to you. He's in the midst of everything falling apart for him. And right there, in the middle of his cry out to God, right? He's asking God to forgive him. If you read on, you'll see that verse 18, he's asking God to forgive him. And then, you know, he's telling the Lord how his family has deserted him and everyone is staying away from him, how he's surrounded with enemies all over the place. He's a broken man, right? But being a broken man, he then says, "Lord, you know everything that I long for. You hear my every sigh." Are you with me, church?
Amen.
David never forgot one thing. He never forgot how deeply God knows him. Do you see that? Do you see that in that verse? Why is it so different for us? When things are not going right for us, we forget. But here is a man who everything has gone so much worse for him, worse than any one of us could possibly experience. But yet he does not forget this one fact. "Lord, you know me deeply." He said, "Lord, you know. You know my every thought. You know my longings. The things that I'm desiring, Lord, you still know them." Amen?
Yeah.
Never, ever forget how deeply God knows you. Even when things are broken beyond repair, remember that he knows you. He knows you so deeply. Amen?
Amen.
But the next one, I want you just to write this down, and perhaps I'll finish it next week. Because God knows me, write this down, please. Because God knows me so deeply, I must make sure never to doubt him. Because God knows me so deeply, I must make sure never to doubt him. And the next title, which I was going to give to you, and we'll cover this another time, is titled "The Danger of Doubting God." Amen? Mm-hmm. You know that it gets to a point where it becomes dangerous to doubt him. When a man who knows you so deeply and knows everything there is to know about you tells you, don't go, and you still go, it becomes dangerous. If you are set in your mind, I'm going to jump and I'm going to make it, and God tells you, don't jump, and you doubt him, that's very dangerous. Are you understanding the church? Can we all stand?